Good morning. Welcome to St. John Vianney. Today we celebrate the 25th Sunday in Ordinary Time, and our opening hymn is number 697, For the Beauty of the Earth, number 697.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And
good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Father.
Our special intention at this Mass is Jack Fisher. We pray for his eternal happiness. We turn to God now with confidence as we ask for forgiveness and grace.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us, Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who founded all the commands of Jesus, all the commands of your sacred law upon love of you and of our neighbor, grant that by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Hear this, you who trample upon the needy and destroy the poor of the land. When will the new moon be over, you ask, that we may sell our grain, and the Sabbath that we may display the wheat? We will diminish the ephah, add to the shekel, and fix our scales for cheating. We will buy the lowly for silver and the poor for a pair of sandals. Even the refuse of the wheat we will sell. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, never will I forget a thing they have done. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, first of all, I ask that supplications, prayers, petitions, and thanksgiving be offered for everyone, for kings, and for all in authority, that we may lead a quiet and tranquil life, in all devotion and dignity. This is good and pleasing to God our Savior, who wills everyone to be saved and to come to knowledge of the truth. For there is one God. There is also one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as ransom for all. This was the testimony at the proper time. For this I was appointed preacher and apostle. I am speaking the truth, I am not lying, teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. It is my wish, then, that in every place the men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with
you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, a rich man had a steward who was reported to him for squandering his property. He summoned him and said, what is this I hear about you? Prepare a full account of your stewardship, because you can no longer be my steward. The steward said to himself, what shall I do now that my master is taking the position of steward away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I'm too ashamed to beg. I know what I shall do, so that when I am removed from the stewardship, they may welcome me into their homes. He called in his master's debtors one by one. To the first, he said, how much do you owe my master? He replied, 100 measures of olive oil. He said to him, here is your promissory note. Sit down and quickly write one for 50. Then to another, the steward said, and how much do you owe? And he replied, 100 cores of wheat. The steward said to him, here is your promissory note. Write one for 80. And the master commended the dishonest steward for acting prudently. For the children of this world are more prudent in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. I tell you, make friends for yourself with dishonest wealth, so that when it fails, you will be welcomed into eternal life. The person who is trustworthy in very small matters is also trustworthy in great ones. And the person who is dishonest in very small matters is also dishonest in great ones. If, therefore, you are not trustworthy with dishonest wealth, who will trust you with true wealth? If you are not trustworthy with what belongs to another, who will give you what is yours? No servant can serve two masters. He will either hate one and love the other, or be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and mammon. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
In this gospel, my sins be wiped away. When will the new moon be over, you ask, that we may sell our grain, and the Sabbath that we may display the wheat? I tell you, make friends for yourself with dishonest wealth, so that when it fails, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I've never liked this gospel passage. I've never been able to fully understand what it means. Now, I'm okay with the parable of the dishonest servant. I can see how we must be prudent in our dealings with people to be able to gain eternal life. It's pretty easy to understand. But this particular verse has always been a stumbling block for me. And I think it's key for understanding the entire passage, this entire scripture passage that Jesus is giving us. Verse 9, I tell you, make friends for yourself with dishonest wealth, so that when it fails, you'll be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Just what is Jesus telling us to do? Certainly, he can't be telling us to be dishonest and to that we need to be dishonest to be welcomed into eternal life. And no, he's not. But what is he telling us? C.H. Dodds, a scripture scholar, once said that a parable is a metaphor that arrests the hearer by its vividness or strangeness and leaves the mind in sufficient doubt about its precise application to tease into it active thought. And this particular passage does that for me. But not only for me, for others as well. I had a parishioner just come up to me before Mass about this very same passage. And also, back through history, the Roman Emperor Julian, known as the apostate because he rejected Christian faith, and he used this particular passage in particular to justify his persecutions of Christians. So let's take a look at this parable and try to discern what's going on here. A steward is caught with his hand in the cookie jar and is going to be fired. He's too lazy to work, too proud to beg. So he decides to buy friends with his master's money. A shrewd move, but also an arrogant one as well. But his master had to admire this act because of the prudence of it, because he's saving his own skin. And Jesus then tells his listeners that if you want to be my follower, if you want to be the children of the light, then you too must act prudently as the dishonest servant did and make friends by using your dishonest wealth. So how are we to understand this? Is he telling us to act dishonestly? And if we take this verse out of context, it certainly seems that way. But that really isn't what's going on here. So who is Jesus talking to when he says these things? That's probably the first thing that we got to realize. And it tells us right at the beginning of the passage that Jesus is talking to his disciples. And that's what we hear. What we don't hear is the verse just following this particular passage. And what that says is that the Pharisees, who love money, heard all these things and sneered at him. But it's not only the Pharisees. Before there were chapter verses, all these Gospels just kind of ran together. And if you read what we read last week, the three parables, the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son, we see at the beginning of that passage that not only are Pharisees, but tax collectors and sinners are listening to the words of Jesus. And this is another parable that follows along with that, even though it's a different chapter in our Bibles. So included in all those are all kinds of sinners, all kinds of people who make their money by dealing dishonestly with people. So what Jesus is telling them is that if they want to be children of the light, if they truly want to be his disciples, if they want to do that, they must, as the prophet Amos tells us in his writings, to seek God and you will live. They must take their dishonest wealth and give it away. They must use it in a way that will gain them virtue and salvation, the true friends that they're trying to buy. And that will gain them a place in among God's friends in heaven. And later in Luke's gospel, we have an opportunity to provide a living example of this with his encounter with Zacharias, the tax collector. Zacharias is seeking the Lord. He wants to live. He climbs a tree to be able to get a view of him and to see him. And Jesus sees him and calls him down and tells him that he's going to dine at his house. And as Jesus enters the house, he tells him, "Half of my goods I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone, I will restore it fourfold." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house. So here is a man seeking repentance. Here is someone that is using his dishonest wealth in exactly the way Jesus wants us to do." This verse, this troublesome verse we have, is nothing but a call to repentance, a recall to all of us sinners to take that dishonest wealth in our lives, whatever that wealth may be, whether it be money, pride, prestige, pleasure, and give it away. Get rid of it. Get rid of it and seek the Lord so that you shall live. And that's the key, I think, to understanding this whole gospel verse. It's what we say at the beginning of Mass in the penitential rite. You came to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. This giving away, this making friends with dishonest wealth is that call to sinners. It's that call to each and every one of us to repent and to seek, as Amos tells us, seek the Lord and you will live. Our passage from Amos tells us the dangers of not having this proper relationship with money. A priest once made the point that you can tell quite a bit about a society by looking at its cities and how its cities are made up. And for a healthy society, the focal point of its cities was its church or temple, the place where the community gathered to worship. Often it faced a square where people would gather to celebrate feasts, trade merchandise, listen to public debates. And most times the courthouse was on that square as well, and the local government being leavened by the moral teachings of the church helped us in our relationship with wealth and power. Yet as societies decline, that paradigm shifts. And no longer is a religion the center of community. No longer is the government leavened by the religious principles of the people. And that focus shifts then, that focus of the community shifts from one of community to one of individualism, a desire for people to obtain the goods and pleasures of that prosperity that prosperity brings. It ignores the plight of the least of their society. And that's the whole purpose of government, is to take care of the least of society. So that's what's going on in our reading from Amos. And after King Solomon, the kingdom of Israel was split into two, the north and the south. And for a while, there was conflict between the two of them and also the neighbors that surrounded them. And that went on for about the first 100 years. But then, with the reign of Jeroboam II, there came a time of peace and prosperity. And with it came dissatisfaction with those religious restrictions. When will the new moon be over, that we may sell our grain? When will the Sabbath be over, so we can show our wheat? We can't be bothered by religious restrictions. There's money to be made. Yet this money is made at the expense of the poor. This is dishonest wealth. But into this prosperity comes Amos, a poor herdsman and a dresser of sycamores sent by God to the northern kingdom from the south to warn them about the errors of his ways. His message is simple: seek the Lord and you will live. Yet he did not endear himself to those who he was speaking to. For he's an unsophisticated man from a poor rural community and preaching to the most sophisticated people of that society. And he was hated for it. The city of Bethel, where he spoke, they had actually built a temple to rival, if you will, the temple of Jerusalem, so that they could do their own thing. And their own thing included a dilution, if you will, of the Hebrew faith, and worship to other gods crept into their rituals. And his message went unheeded, and soon the northern kingdom was overthrown. The fall of the royal house happened, and the people were taken into captivity, never to be seen again. 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel disappeared and were lost. That's the faith, and that's the path that dishonest wealth takes you. Not only wealth, but all the things of this world, if we use them in a way that does not build up the kingdom of God. Seek me and you will live, God tells his people. Our scripture reading today tells us much about human nature when it comes to the relationship of wealth, both on an individual and a societal level. The person who is trustworthy in very small matters is also trustworthy in great ones. Likewise, dishonesty in small matters means dishonesty in great ones. The steward was dishonest in both small and great things, and the northern kingdom as well. For both led to a loss of the wealth that is really important, that kingdom of God. And for us, the same thing applies. So compared to salvation, money is but a small matter, and if we desire the treasure of eternal life, we will be honest in all the details of our lives. It's our human nature that we have this desire to pursue the things that we think will make us happy. Power, wealth, prestige, pleasure. And objectively, these are not necessarily bad things. It's only when we replace God with them, when we allow them to be our master rather than our Lord, that we have problems. And this is why Jesus tells us that we cannot serve two masters. If we make money our master, we will not be able to serve God. And this is true not only for the people of the northern kingdom, the people for the time of Christ, but for us today as well. So let us all resolve to seek God in whatever we do, to be trustworthy in all matters, great and small, so that Christ might raise us from the dust to sit us with the princes of his own house. Praise the Lord who lifts up the poor. Amen. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven,
and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate in the Virgin Mary and became man.
For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with God and the Son is glory and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
With confidence that God loves us, we turn to God now with the prayers on our minds and in our hearts.
May the Holy Spirit guide the church and its shepherds to proclaim the gospel and to bring healing to our world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all priests, deacons, and men and women in consecrated life, and for an increase in those vocations, we pray to the Lord. For the wisdom and prudence to be good stewards of God's manifold gifts to us, we pray to the Lord. For all people who struggle with mental illness and for their families and caregivers, we pray to the Lord. For the safety of our troops and first responders, we pray to the Lord. For a respect for every human life from conception till natural death, we pray to the Lord. For the people of our sister parishes in Mexico, Nicaragua, and Mississippi, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For what other intention shall we pray? Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. For those intentions we hold in our heart, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and for all those mentioned in our parish prayer book, may they feel God's love and healing presence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead, especially for Deacon Alfredo Hidalgo, may they be welcomed into the kingdom of heaven where every tear is wiped away. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Jack Fisher, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Mighty God, we thank you that your constant love for us encourages us to turn to you in, with these prayers through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Our hymn during the preparation of the gifts is number 910, Take and Eat, number 910. Oops, sorry, I was misinformed. Turn to the beginning of the book, number 69. I don't know what it is. The Cry of the Poor, number 69.
Thank you.
My sisters and brothers, let us pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that this partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Wilton, our bishop, all the clergy, and all your faithful people. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, her spouse, St. Joseph, the blessed apostles, St. John Vianney, and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of God's peace.
Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So most of you see me here on Saturdays and Sundays, but my Monday through Friday is spent at a different place that's right around the corner. And I have been blessed to be able to work for Calvert Hospice for the last 3 years. And when I went to work there, I thought, I know what hospice does. After all, I'm in the bereavement ministry here, and many, many of the people that have come through here have been patients through Calvert Hospice and received services. So I went in there pretty confident that I knew what they did. After a very short time, however, I realized I had no idea of the magnitude of services that they do actually provide to the community. Everyone knows about our clinical teams, our nurses, our caretakers. Well, what I found out was about the bereavement teams. We have chaplains who work with our families. Deacon Ed Baker from St. Anthony's is also volunteers with us to help us with anyone whose religious affiliation is Catholic, so that we can provide some of the sacramental things that they desire. And we have social workers who help families through all of it, even into the funeral planning issues. And we have counselors that work with grief support. And we have two, one's for adults and one's for teens and children. And I did not know we have drop-in grief support groups all through the county. They're centrally located in the south, the center, and then in the north. And we also have specialized groups for grief support. We have ones that are on infant loss, suicide, substance abuse loss, and spousal loss. And those groups run, you know, for 6 to 8 weeks. We have an information table in the back if that's of interest to anyone. Our child counselor works within our schools, and she's been able to establish groups in all of the schools in Calvert County, working with grief support with our kids, which is really a big thing because kids need a place to talk about their grief too. And they also run a camp, Camp Phoenix. It's a 3-day camp. And I have been able to work there for the last 2 years, and it just amazes me that in those 3 days to watch the kids and for them to understand that there are other children who have experienced the same loss and a safe place for them to talk about that loss. I also want to make sure that you understand that these services through our bereavement are available to all residents of Calvert County, not just our hospice families. It's open to everyone, and we do not turn anyone away. We also have a group of 80 volunteers who help us. We call them our unpaid staff because we couldn't operate without them. I have several from St. John Vianney who come to my office and have been my second set of hands, have helped me tremendously. I don't know what I would do without them. They help in our shop, they help in the community, and we even have a special program that's called Vet to Vet, and that's veterans talking to other veterans. It seems that they understand some of the experiences they may have had in their service to our country. So if there's anybody who is either in active military or currently a veteran, and you would be interested in volunteering for that, please call our office and talk to Amanda. She'll put you in contact with someone. So to provide all these services, what I found out was that we depend on donations. We're not state funded, we're not federally funded, we are self-sufficient, self-sustaining. We're a nonprofit. And one of our crown jewels is our house. It's the Burnett Calvert Hospice House. Many of you know it, it's on Sixes Road. This was a house that was, we called, that was built from love. The generous citizens of Calvert County and businesses built that house for us 10 years ago. And it was totally paid for. They gave that house to us mortgage free, which was a gift. But we are left to maintain. So when it's 10 years, so we find that the house, as any of you house owners know, You find some things that need fixing around the house. So this is our 10th year. So we're finding all those little things that need to be upgraded in the house. So like I said, we depend on donations from people like you and from grants and other services in our community. We started a campaign earlier this summer that, because it was the house that love built out of their hearts, the love in their hearts. So we called it Open Your Heart. And we're hoping that the same community that helped us once can help us again to maintain what we have. So what I'm asking you is to pray about that. And if you can find it in your heart to help Calvert Hospice, no donation is too small. And we also, there's many other ways that you can help fund. We have some ideas on that in the brochure. So I asked if you could just pray about that and maybe think that you could open your heart to hospice so that you can help us be with families when they need us the most. Thank you.
We extend a warm welcome to all who are visiting in the parish. If you had your picture taken for the parish pictorial directory, you can pick up your free copy of the directory in the festival room. If you did not get your picture taken and you would like to buy a directory for $10, we can take your name and place an order for additional copies. Please support our seminarians, our parishioner seminarian Marcus Lloyd, and our summer seminarian John McMahon are both running in the Marine Corps 10 kilometers. See the flyer in the bulletin on how you can support them and all of our seminarians. This year's Oktoberfest, sponsored by the Knights of Columbus, is Saturday, October 5th. Tickets are on sale today after Mass. Please join us for this annual fun event with good food and live music. The funds raised support the charitable projects our Knights do for our parish and our community. You can also see the flyer in the bulletin for more information. The Knights Ladies Auxiliary also have their basket raffle in the festival room. And please stand now for our closing prayer. Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption, both in mystery and in the manner of our life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Our recessional hymn is number 713, Lord of All Hopefulness, number 713.